never know what will happen at Worlds.
The stage is set, the curtain is drawn.
没人能够预见会是这种情况.
This is the game people want to see.
新的王者诞生了.
Kaboom! They lit the fuse.
你看到了吗?
They're gonna win. This is it.
Just when you think the surprises were left in the play-in groups, the knockout stage delivered us a nail-biter. Best of five to kick things off today starts with the hope of the OPL, Legacy Esports versus hometown favorites LGD. Here we get an inside look at the Shanghai control room through the lens of the Oppo cam, capturing all of those great moments from Worlds 2020. Hello, I'm Machine, locked and loaded with two of the minds here ready to go ahead and bring you League of Legends action. Kaedral and Vedius in the studio. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Kaedral the natural and Vedius with a very natural blonde as well.
Thank
yeah, good
much.
To see you.
How
welcome.
You
I'm getting caffeinated, if I'm honest. It's a bit of an early start. It's the last one of my shift here at Worlds. But yesterday, the LPL's LGD looked to be back in form. They swept through the LLA's Rainbow Seven out of the tournament just like that. While the second series of the day, well, a very different story. It went the full five games with Turkey Supermassive taking down the LEC's Mad Lions, fourth seed from Europe, no longer in the competition.
Yeah, we don't need to talk about that. We can just swiftly...
yeah,
we
right.
Three seeds anyway. Yeah. That never happened.
LGD, wow. Looking like a great team. Really coming in convincing yesterday, Machine. I think that the individual disparity between them and Rainbow Seven was pretty significant. Yeah. And I think that we did get to see a little bit of a return to form of the LGD roster that many people were expecting coming into the tournament.
Yeah, and on a serious note towards Mad Lions, I think they just didn't find the comfort in the meta. I feel like they were trying to default back to center Wukong, trying to find things that worked for them. But I could never really see a champion where I could look at Shadow and say, yeah, he looks confident or comfortable on that champion. There was never really any game where it stood out where he could carry the games or do much. And I think Kakao, it was a bit of a diffy in the jiffy for me. Humanoid was stepping up, Karzai was stepping up, but there was just not enough team cohesion to bring it through.
And in terms of like individual shining lights, Jose Diodo, I'm trying not Diodo. To butcher that, Diodo, screw you, first of all. But other than that, other than his name being hard to pronounce, he really did impress and turn some heads here on the international stage.
Yeah, I think he did. And I think that it was cool to hear from some of his teammates that he is considered the best player in Latin America. And I think that there is a bright future still ahead of them. Going up against LGD is no easy feat, and I think that it's still good to hear from the players that they were able to learn a lot from this experience, and they turned a lot of heads, as you rightly say, going 2-2 in the group stage, definitely more than they've been able to achieve in the past.
Absolutely, and it's a completely unprecedented level of stage for their kind of League of Legends. Supermassive with a massive win for the TCL, and now they face against Unicorns of Love today. At least one emerging region makes it out of groups. It's happening. It's a guarantee. It's in the brackets. It's in the tea leaves. We know it's happening. It wasn't quite one to be disappointed by the European.
No, I think that it's really exciting for Supermassive once again. Of course, Turkey have been able to qualify for the group stages a few times with various different teams in the past, but for a team like the Unicorns of Love, for the CIS, this is a region that has come to this best of five position multiple times and has failed to qualify so many times before. I was worried for them. I thought that it was going to be Mad Lions versus them once again, and it would be Mad Lions knocking them out just like Splice did last year. But now they don't have to go up against the European team. They go up against the Turkish representatives, and I think that they do have a real shot of making it today.
Yeah, and it's going to be such a close match. I mean, like you said, it's the fourth chance they're going to get Unicorns to get in, or the CIS in general, to get into the World's group stage. And Supermassive, for me, look slightly stronger just based on the pop-off players they have. I think their top jungle looked so solid yesterday, and Snowflower on the engages looks crazy good.
Yeah, and I'm afraid we are going to have to rip that band-aid off now, fellas. Yes, it is our jobs. We do our due diligence here. Mad Lions eliminate. That's Europe's fourth seed, and we haven't seen one of the European seeds fail in the play-ins before. This is an unprecedented territory, Vedius, and I want you to just ease us into this one. Like, lower me into the water gently. Let's talk about it. Let's reflect on the departure of Mad Lions here.
Yeah, Europe as a region now is terrible.
Oh, yes.
It's all over for us.
Overrated.
World, we're completely overrated.
Completely overrated.
We never deserved a fourth seed.
Yes, that's right. We,
of course. We're just, of course, jokes aside. Mad Lions, I think that it's... given their recent performance, it's easy to forget how amazing of a year they did have.
Yes.
They managed to defeat G2 domestically in a best of five, which was the first team to do it against this roster.
Yep.
They were able to make it to third and then fourth, respectively. Like, the team has had a fantastic year for a rookie squad. And now, rookies in the past have been able to turn heads on the international stage, but unfortunately, this wasn't the year for them. And as Mark said, they struggled to find their identity. They struggled to find ways in which they could overcome some of their weaknesses, and they struggled. But it's also a large part of the learning process, and I imagine that based on our rookies that we've had here in Europe, next year they're going to look better than ever.
Kadril, in terms of learning lessons, I'm sure it's not easy, especially from a player's viewpoint, to sit there and remind yourself, hey, these are valuable lessons I've learned, when your hopes and dreams of a world's group stage have been shattered. But given time, you think this could be a valuable experience for Mad Lions?
Definitely. I mean, it's obviously super disappointing. I think it's the first time Europe's never really made it out of play-in, so it's a really... It's a hard one to sort of burden. I think that Mad Lions, obviously, they have four brand new players to the world stage, so it's probably a big learning experience for them. They had so many games on stage, they probably scrimmed most of the international teams, so going home is going to suck, but coming into next year, it's something they can reflect on, and it's something they can try to improve.
And be entirely different people based on the experience they've had over in Shanghai. And another experience we had was a bit of a lesson, a bit of a tutorial from Kakao on the Lilia. It was a champion that we've seen an awful lot of over the course of this last week. But check this one out. This is Kadril giving me some extra jungle lessons.
Yeah, and I think the thing that separated Kakao from most of the Lilias in the plains was the aggression. Most Lilias, they like the full clear, then get level 6, look for neutrals, but Kakao, one camp into the enemy buff, and the way it works is he just brings his laner so much, like you'll see later on, and a level 2 Azir comes in to help him out, and he's just being such a nuisance, spotting out Shadow, trying to waste as much of his time as he can, because he's not going to sit there and farm up to late game like the other junglers do on Lilia. So he brings over Blulu, and then not only Blulu, he brings over Snowflower as well, so he can take the blue, and the whole concept behind it is just, he can snowball from this really fast, takes away the blue, takes away the wolves, then he'll come back later, take the secondary respawn camps, and just in general, just like exponentially grows him out, and Shadow always two levels down in these matchups when Kakao was on the Lilia. And I just think the way it works is either his lanes come and push you out to take the camps, or Shadow's lanes have to come and cover him, and then his lanes can get the push, and then he can just back off and his job's done.
Yeah, some hard-hitting analysis actually I want to provide is that Kakao has done very well on four-legged champions. So just keep your eyes on that. Keep your eyes on that. But another highlight from the TCL champs was Snowflower's Alistar, whose flank against Mad Lions earned him Red Bull's top play. Let's watch this one again.
Yeah, this was crazy. I mean, this is a split-second decision-making right here. They contest the mid-wave, and they're contesting mid-wave a bit too far forward. As the Galio ult comes in, the Hecarim ult, you can just see that as soon as Snowflower pulls the trigger, everyone's just instantly ready to respond.
And I think this was also a testament to how well Supermassive did play yesterday. I think that throughout the series, even though there was a lot of draft debates online around, like, it felt like each game was being given depending on who had the better draft. Yeah. I felt like the Supermassive were consistently making better decisions, and it felt like to me that they were willing to punish a lot more of the mistakes that we saw from Mad Lions. So props to Supermassive. They're going to give us a very exciting best of five.
Yep.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. Absolutely not. And there's only two spots left in the group stage. So 22 names will be stepping on, and we only have two spots left, Legacy and LGD, Supermassive and UOL. It all comes down to this. And as we kick off the final day of Worlds Play-ins.
Legacy versus LGD will be our first series. Can the OPL take down the LPL?
LGD really turned it around from what was a disheartening start to the play-ins.
Mark goes in, Hase goes down. LGD, they find their chance and they immediately just jump on it.
Take notes, OPL guys, this is a little terrifying.
Let's see, Sports, you don't expect such a small region to actually perform to this extent.
So he's gonna win, Talahino, it's raised against the Dragon, and now he's gonna start shooting down the duo lane.
Oh! It's one of those surreal moments. The whole region has done the right thing. They've finally rallied behind the boys.
If they take down LGD, they're guaranteed the group stage for the first time. Don't let me down, Oceania.
Supermassive versus Unicorns of Love. One final shot for the LCL and the TCL to qualify for groups. Big stakes for everyone, but one thing we know is that one of the smaller regions will be making it through. Will it be Turkey?
To shift things back in his favor. Unstoppable now as Bolulu goes into the fight. Big haymaker across the backside, and Kakao is playing cleanup.
Since the introduction of the playing stage back in 2017, the LCL have yet to have a champion crack onto the group stage. The Unicorns of Love are looking to make history.
Rat-a-tat-tat, LGD
it's
goes flat, the flash away, go, go, go!
Will they be able to show up when it matters to get over that final hurdle?
The OPL has never had a team in groups, but today could be the day for Legacy to make history. And joining us in the studio now is their expert, Spawn, joining us live. And he's actually put on a collar, dressing up. Oh, my goodness.
Damn.
Very exciting to see you, Spawn. How are you doing, man?
Yeah, I'm doing really well. And as you mentioned, Machine, you know, we had to dust off the suit because today could be that historic day. Legacy, one of the oldest organizations within the OPL, is going up against the LPL's fourth seed in LGD. And I think that this is one of those moments that Oceanic fans have been waiting for, that slow climb to relevancy. We finally had a terrific group stage. We haven't fallen down. In fact, in the last couple of years, we've only lost four games to North America and one game to the LCL. This certainly feels like the Oceanic team that can finally make it to that group stage.
But Spawn, I feel like it's so ambitious when you're going up against LGD. Like, the biggest disparity between LGD and Rainbow Seven was individual talent. And I struggle to believe that the OPL with this Legacy roster will be able to match up to players like GA, like Peanut on an individual level.
Yeah, but Vetti, you also struggled to believe that they could take down Mad Lions, and that one seemed to come.
Oh, God.
Let me tell you about the team called League's Greatest Disappointment. I believed in LGD in the past, and it made me look like a fool on the international stage. But I do agree, individually, they seem to match up well. But Legacy hasn't cared about that all year long. This is a team that has implicit trust in their members. We're finally seeing Raze have those pop-up team fight moments, and I think that LGD will make mistakes, and Legacy will just be there to capitalize on them and win out in the team fighting that we've seen so much throughout play-ins.
It doesn't necessarily inspire confidence when your win condition is the failure of your opponent, but Spawn, congratulations for having confidence in it. Respect, man. Thank you so much, and we'll see you later on. We'll keep checking in with you during that Worlds cooldown.
No worries. Thanks very much.
Peace, man. Much love. After a tumultuous group stage, LGD took care of business yesterday, though, against Rainbow Seven. So my question here is, is it safe to say that LGD are back, you know, or is day one, day two LGD, are they around the corner at any moment?
It's so hard to say sometimes. Yeah, I mean, the best of fives are definitely their comfort zone, I think, throughout the playoffs and the regional qualifiers and stuff like this. They were obviously more comfortable in best of fives. I think best of one never really benefits anyone in general. So the stronger teams are, well, stronger when I say LGD, are definitely going to benefit the best of fives more. I just think the biggest thing for me was adaptation over the course of the play-ins. I think that they came into the play-ins with things like dilution and stuff like this and Peanut on the Lee Sin and stuff like this. It wasn't working. Just go back to default, go back to scaling, which is what they learned. They went back to the Orianna, the Graves, Nidalee, stuff like this. So they've adapted really well, and I think their team fighting's got a lot better. And just in general, I mean, if you look at LGD, they have one of the biggest gold leads at 15, at 20 minutes, stuff like this throughout the play-ins, but they're losing most of their games, and that's because the meta is not early game.
With those five names on screen, Vedius, do you believe that Legacy can pound for pound keep up with the names like that?
Well, so I don't. I personally don't. And I think that when we heard from Spawn, he was telling us about how, yeah, it does seem a little bit rough, but he's expecting that Legacy will be able to turn it around in terms of their team play. And this is also where Kadra and I look a lot at some of the draft options that both these teams are thinking about, because it feels to me that there are a lot of similarities in terms of their play style, especially when you look at things like the jungle. We noticed that things like the Nidalee and the Graves are actually two very important picks that we think are going to be very prevalent in this series.
Yeah, Nidalee, Graves. Babip has 100% win rate on Nidalee going into this tournament. So it's a bit scary. They both kind of realize that these are the priority junglers. They're both kind of contesting them. And then moving across to the mid lane as well, you can see them both in the middle of the screen, TF and Galio. You've got Tali on the Galio, CA on the TF, sort of like their identity champs of just roaming around. They look really strong with both their ults and just helping out the jungles.
And I think it's really fascinating as well, because when we look at these mid-jungle duos, I think that for LGD, it's been extremely prominent. And for Legacy, I think it's going to be a large part of what helped them maintain some control during the early game. Because when you look back at their game versus Team Liquid, it was the early game where they struggled. They punished picks like the Galio. But the question is, will Xie be able to do a similar thing on his Twisted Fate? He was able to do it against Rainbow Seven yesterday. But I wonder if they're going to be able to do it again against Legacy when Tali is so comfortable on this champ.
Yeah, and talking about pound for pound, if they're both roaming in mid, then there's not much of a 1v1. So it's going to be team orientated. And then the last champion you saw on your screen was the Leona. I think Mark on this Leona, it's his most played champion in LPL. It's one of his best champions. You really don't want to give it to him, so I wouldn't be surprised to see that banned away or contested going into this series.
I ultimately think we're going to see a lot of roaming, a lot of team fighting, a lot of action-packed, pretty much largely coming from the jungle supports with the mid laners looking to roam around the map, which is why we talked a lot about the team identities and why these champions are going to be so prominent in this map.
And a nice vague sweeping statement from me, which is my specialty, is that I actually am intrigued because we've spoken or we heard from Legacy about Chaos and thriving within it. As much as it may just sound like hyperbole, I believe there is some truth in that, that Legacy, when the game, it feels chaotic, frantic, that is the equalizer against some of these bigger names. So my question is you know, LGD could succumb to that chaos. It's not like their games have been clean. A lot of their victories, LGD fans are still sitting there in the forums going, yay, Peanut did something, you know, like, they're still being mean in victories. Perhaps that chaos could give Legacy a way in.
Yeah, they need to control the beast and the beasts themselves when it comes to LGD. They need to stop going for like solo plays, splitting off, trying to make hero plays, or even in general, just misplaying team fights by mispositioning. So they need to stay as a ball. There's been so many fights where they split up 3-2 on dragon fights, they tried to collapse, and we've seen so many team fights throughout play-ins where the five-man ball that turns onto the three or the two always wins, and LGD were always the ones on the three and the two. So they need to stay together, and they need to not get sort of caught out by this team comp or these team fights that LGC throw at them.
But I think what the reoccurring conversation has been is like, as long as LGD don't mess up, it feels like that this is just their series to win, right? And I think that when you are Legacy, and as Spawn was saying, like, it does feel like that they are the underdogs in the series, but that also takes a lot of the pressure off of them. And, you know, pressure has been such a big thing when we look at in this tournament, like Mad Lions, they carry the weight of EU's first fourth seed, and they couldn't, they succumb to the pressure.
I mean, look LGD, what it did to LGD.
Right, like LGD is struggling as well. And like, obviously we can't speak from their perspective, but you can imagine that weight. Whereas LPL, this is opportunity, this is hope. And I saw it on Twitter, this could potentially be one of the biggest upsets in world's history because OPL have never been able to qualify for the world's group stage. And to do so by taking down LGD would definitely be an impressive feat. And
if nothing to lose, everything to gain.
And if OPL takes down LGD, then it takes the burden off Europe a little bit more. Yeah. So let's go Legacy.
Suddenly we're whipping our Commonwealth flags. Yeah, let's go Australia. Woo. But with that said, any of you want to put your money where your mouth is? Any of you want to back Legacy in the predictions of this one? I'm looking at you, Vedi. We got some extended eye contact then.
No.
No?
I'm going with the LGD. I'm even going with the 3-0 LGD. I think that the individual difference is so big between these two teams that obviously, some massive draft differences can compensate for that. But yeah, my confidence right now is in the LGD camp. I think they figured out their issues. I think they were a lot more patient in their objective play. And I think they're going to take the series today.
Another day in the office for LGD, who do seem to have turned it on and are back to their winning ways. Kadra, what's your thoughts?
I don't know, man.
Think out loud for us.
My head, I've been thinking about this for the last couple of minutes. My head's telling me 3-1 LGD, but my heart's saying it could go to 5 games because I just think LGD makes so many mistakes and they grief it too much. And I just think Taze on Ezreal and stuff like this has been carrying and just playing so well. So I'm going to say 3-2 LGD.
Okay.
Maybe it's a bit controversial to say it's going to go to 5 games in this kind of series, but I think it's going to go to 5 games. Yeah.
And I'm going to raise my hand with an opinion that doesn't matter and say that I actually believe that there is a world where the mental side aids them. If Legacy have a nutty draft and convert a quick first 20-minute game, there is a world where they can just completely get the mental edge over LGD and they're all tilted and salty and they do stupid things. I'm just saying, there's a world.
I can tell you right now, the online, the raise your koalas spam is high.
Yes.
There is so
much the boys
for the OPL right now. So I think that support and enthusiasm is definitely going to be behind the Legacy squad.
Yeah, exactly. And with that said, let's send it over to Pastry, who I'm sure is going to be excited. Crumbs as well. Game one of Legacy Esports versus LGD.
Certainly am excited, Alex. Thank you so much. As Crumbs, let's get in with a qualifying best of five, the first of two here for the World's Plan stage. It is as it is about to come to a close, where one of these two teams will be one of two remaining teams to qualify for the main event at Worlds 2020.
It's a huge moment for Australia. Oceania could actually end up toppling an incredibly powerful team here in LGD, which the advantage coming into this Pastry is that regionally, this team only plays best of series, so they should be in their element here playing more games already, having warmed up to what their compositions or what their playstyles are best suited to. And a large part of it, we already heard from the desk, is just that mid 2v2. Is Peanut and GA going to be so powerful that Legacy does not even survive past the laning phase? Because we have seen what Tally can do with his flanks, but We've also seen what happens when he doesn't get out of laning phase, especially the matches against Team Liquid. To me, that was a big indication for where Legacy's weaknesses were at. They were having a really tough time against Jensen in the mid lane. Picks like Twisted Fate and Orianna are really tough because if you're playing against a Twisted Fate, you need to be a mid laner that can punish and keep him shoved in. If you're playing against champions like the Orianna, you have to be able to farm, you have to be able to trade and ganker. Tally looks like he's a top laner that just snuck into the mid lane. Those are not the skill sets that are actually punishing the champions that CEA's got.
Yeah, I mean, Tally's roaming's been great, his team fighting's been excellent, he's a veteran presence, a big voice on this team, I'm sure. But he's got quite the opponent today in Shea, and especially if Peanut is on form once again. So let's see what the draft brings us. That's a sight for sore eyes. Orianna, get her out of there. It's going to be the first ban for Legacy.
Great first ban there. I thought LGD was going to really put a prioritization on that one, and both teams are just targeting their mid laners, recognizing how important this matchup is going to be. Okay,
I think we've
identified the same thing that Legacy has, which is that the mid lane matchup is going to be absolutely crucial. Ornn is another pick that obviously has been risen in priority, and it's one that goes really well with what LGD is trying to do, which is putting Peanut on these carry junglers in the Kindred. Not even going to allow them to have it banned away. He had so many games of it in the previous series. Let's see if he can actually play these mages better, or he'll just prioritize the Graves or Lee Sin.
Very curious what this final LGD ban is. It's Lucian. Wow, going to respect that out of Talia, and I guess maybe Raze or Tarpoon as well. Talia has had one play of the Lucian so far this world. Didn't look great on it, but certainly can play it, as Nidalee is going to be the first pick here for Babbitt, presumably. And that was kind of what I was going to point out, you know, with so few junglers touched here, and with Babbitt and Peanut being a pretty important matchup in the early game between these two teams. Curious to see what Peanut wants to select here. Does he take something like the Lillia? Does he take the Graves? Because I think whatever the jungle matchup is, it's going to be pretty aggressive between the two junglers. But LGD can wait to pick it. They'll go with an extremely strong start to this draft. Renekton and Twisted Fate.
Yeah, already picking on the sidelines. It's going to be tough for Tarpoon to deal with this if ZA is unlocked, which we can assume will happen. As Tally, we don't know what mid laners he's got to be able to actually punish this champion. You want control mages. You want to be able to keep Twisted Fate pushed in and maybe pair him with some ganks from the Nidalee. At the very least, the Nidalee won't have the Renekton to have these really strong topside combinations, but you still have other kinds of champions. Tally's going to go with the Galio. They'll try to match that global with his own.
I like it. You know, he needs to get out of lane, needs to roam, needs to have effectiveness in skirmishes and team fights. This is a pick that he looked excellent on, despite getting pushed around in lane a little bit, but Shea may punish him even more than he's potentially expecting. We'll see what the form looks like from LGD's mid laner as the games go on. And I like this. Bit of a difference here for Tarpoon. He can play tanks, he can play carries. Going to get Gangplank here in this draft.
Interesting pick there. I mean, you're going to have a fine time against the Renekton. You can obviously orange out of the Twisted Fate cards, but you don't know what the backline of LGD is thus far. And ideally, you want to be able to use that Gangplank ultimate on top of some immobile carries, zone them out from a team fight, and you already have a really good way of just splitting the enemy's composition and gaining advantages in the team fight that way. But now that you have a Nidalee with a Gangplank and a Galio, you can assume that Legacy Esports wants to play the early game fairly control, wait for that level 6, and then pop off.
I mean, if nothing else, an extra global might not hurt if she is going to be teleporting around the map, as Caitlyn's going to be banned here in phase 2. It's been all topside picks here for both of these teams, so I imagine we'll see a number of bottom lane focus bans here on either side. Very curious to see how Kramer and Raze kind of shake out as well. These are, I guess I'll call them late game insurance policies for these teams. Very good team fighters. Raze has had an excellent tournament, but Kramer is kind of creeping up in power alongside the rest of LGD as Rakan is going to be taken away from Mark.
I think Jhin would be so good here for Legacy's composition. Being able to combo a root from a Gangplank ultimate to keep somebody in that center is really devastating, as well as pairing quite well with the Nidalee. It actually allows you to keep a distance from what LGD's composition wants to do, and they're targeting away this hard engage. Mark had some really insane fights against Rainbow Seven. They don't want to see any of that again. Rakan has been rising in priority so much during the play-ins. I think this is a pick that we can just expect to continue to rise in priority for all the teams moving forward. The ability to engage and peel at the same time is just unparalleled, and they combo super well with some ADs that we have yet to see in this series or from these two teams, which has been the Twitch.
Yep, Twitch, certainly a pick we'll also be keeping our eyes on if either of these teams do want to pick that one up. But Ezreal going to be banned on the Legacy side, so respecting the power of the pick, despite Raze looking very good on that champion. Kramer also perfectly good Ezreal, so keeping that one out of his hands as Leona's going to get picked up here. They're counterpicking AD here.
Ooh, very interesting. Yeah, the counterpick and AD. I mean, we've already seen what some teams feel comfortable doing. We saw yesterday Supermassive bust out a Vayne as a counterpick, if you will. Didn't really work out, but we know that there's quite a bit that you can do from the AD department now that Caitlyn has dropped in priority and is banned entirely. It's going to be a Kalista instead. Wow, Kalista, Taric. It's been such a long time since we've seen this combo. Twitch is going to be an insane team fighter and late game insurance, but also there's just too many. We're just going
to... Yep. Curious to see the Leona picked where it was, because typically Leona would block Rakan, but Rakan was already banned, so you don't have to worry about that. But there might be something different coming here for the LGD bottom lane if they're going to pick Leona where they did. Well, wait for the clock to count down. It's not Swain. It's going to be MF there for Kramer.
Just pure team fighting from LGD, and then you've got a Twisted Fate that's going to be able to roam and help you in the laning phase already. So I think that the teams have gotten everything that they've wanted, and it's now about to see if they can actually enforce those win conditions and those areas that we thought would be problematic for both the team fighting in LGD and the early laning from LGC.
Yep, I think the obvious places who are already going to look at, we'll continue to look at after seeing this draft. Babip versus Peanut is going to be a lot, but who can get the early foothold in the jungle 1v1? And of course, Xie versus Tali is going to be the matchup probably throughout the whole series, because I think it's where the biggest skill discrepancy lies. So Tali's going to have to do a very good job to keep track of Xie's Twisted Fate, which as soon as Twisted Fate gets loose, game devolves very quickly if that global presence can be felt as often as Twisted Fate wants it to be. So coaches are going to fist bump, and we'll play game one, or at least start game one, very shortly here. Best of five between these two teams. You said already, Crumbs. LGD have played so many best of fives already before this tournament even started. Played one yesterday. See how they look today.
It should be their comfort zone, and they've chosen to have a pretty strong mid 2v2 pairing, which is where I think the game is going to be decided right now. You've got Twisted Fate and Graves. Graves is going to feel comfortable to invade and have that global to back him up. But on the flip side, Nidalee and the Galio can also offer quite a deadly combination. The taunt into a spear follow-up, or just Nidalee pouncing in and allowing Galio's ultimate to have a really nice position, can be quite devastating in these fights. So I want to see what the attention towards the mid lane ends up looking like, because both these junglers have the opportunity to play very aggressive in the invades, which is what we have seen from Peanut. Despite different champions, we saw from the analyst desk, Cadrill was highlighting how the Lilia was being played, being very aggressive and in your face, and that kind of playstyle can work very well early, because Twisted Fate will have that shove against the Galio early on. He needs a few more levels to be able to wave clear safely and then assist in those roams.
I mean, Peanut's old nickname was the Battle Lord, right? He would get so much information and vision just by running into the enemy jungle and fighting whoever was there. I mean, that's aggressive jungler is kind of what Peanut came up in the scene being known for, and he's been very successful on a variety of different teams in the LCK and of course now in the LPL. So you could tell why there was a worry that, you know, LGD would kind of power up as the tournament went on, even though they did look not great at play-ins in the early stages, and they are still prone to mistakes. The individual skill, especially between their star players, is pretty outrageous. So we'll have to see if Legacy are up to the task. But it's a long series for either of these two teams. Their last shot at qualifying for the World's Main Event is here. We'll see what happens here in game number one.
Okay, I think that LGD is just so focused on making sure that Xie pops off, and that's something that we haven't seen that much Twisted Fate priority in the tournament thus far. It really was a pick that dominated the global meta a few months prior, and then it really fell off. But if you remember how dominant the Twisted Fate can be to the side lanes, you can see how explosive LGD's composition can get, because when it gets to a point where the Renekton is shoving in the Gangplank in the top side, and then you've got Misfortune to be able to hit that level 6 in combo with a Leona, it is really tough for the side laners of Legacy to be able to survive if a Twisted Fate gets online. So you need to really prioritize vision around the mid lane as well. It's not just a matter about shoving, it's about knowing exactly where he is and not giving Twisted Fate the opportunities to use that port. We want to look at that first ultimate as well. These global ultimates that want to get ahead are so important in the early game for having that first one really pay dividends, or else you're really going to slow yourself down.
Peanut's already at it, moving in, clears out a ward. Does have that sweeper. In fact, both junglers have an early sweeper already. but no invades by the looks of things here as the teams are just spread out across the riff. We'll take a look at Raze with some pretty aggressive Callista runes, but I wouldn't say nothing out of the ordinary. I do like that both these bottom lanes are a little bit more aggressive than what we've been seeing, right? Kramer on the MF, Raze here on the Callista. Mark has Ignite. Isles has the heal instead because Raze has Cleanse. Thanks, Leona. Kind of forcing the tax on that summoner spell there, but there's going to be a little bit more play, I think, in the mid game between these two marksmen or two bottom lanes. Whereas we've seen, you know, a decent amount of Twitch, a lot of Apps, a lot of Caitlyn. Picks up want to scale a bit more. I think both teams know that they're expecting to fight a little bit earlier than normal.
They have to. This is what is going to be happening when you're playing these early game junglers that can be so aggressive and ranged at the same time. They can really exploit their lanes having priority, and you just have to back off and contest because the mid laners can collapse so effectively as well. So we see that the junglers are actually ended up taking very different routes, as Raze is going to do red to blue path all the way back to the top set and just a full clear from Legacy's Bad Baby. So he's going to put a little bit of an extra focus into the bottom lane. I don't think that Peanut will end up pathing to the bottom side for an early gank. There is that cleanse on the Callista, making her a lot harder to lock down. So you're best off just playing off of mid, who's just continuing to shove the Galio under the turret. This is the area that we thought was going to be really important here, and Tally's doing a fine job in farming, but he's already losing some HP.
Yeah, so yeah, he took Stack Deck level 1, played very aggressive up on the wave. His Peanut is going to take a chip down the bottom lane, but mid lane, here's Vivip. Tally already with a taunt, does get it off, and the spear is not going to cake. Now Xie is going to have to run away, but here's the same story in the bottom lane as Ray is likely forced to flash, does hop over there, so Isle's going to have to flash out instead, and Peanut, he took a tower shot. As Vivip's going to go back in, the Q though, not going to connect, just barely sails past the minion wave.
Both junglers really trying to make their mark in this early game, but Babip does not have the red buff, so he's not going to be able to fight Peanut unless he lands a really good spear. His gank in the mid lane just didn't find the right angle for it to connect. He would have been able to force a flash out of the Twisted Fate had that been a bottom little bit more patient here. Looking for one bottom spear.
Oh, he got hit! What are you doing? That shoot's going to proc, but there's the stun landing on it. Into the smoke screen goes Babip, so no first blood. But everyone's going to walk away as Kramer had to burn both summoners there.
He should have known that the Nidalee was in that side of the map. After all, Grace just dodged the spear that came from that same angle. So the fact that the Misfortune lost all summoners is a big lapse in judgment there. Now we're back to Nidalee having priority here and is going to be able to double crab the Graves if she passes to the top side right away. And looks like she's just hunting him down, trying to make sure that she knows where he's at, sees that the camp is already taken, can deduce that the Graves is going all the way to the top crab.
Should have the info. You can see the LGD ping on Babip's location as well. Know that he's likely around that area, and they would be correct in that deduction. Ooh, Long Xing smacking that barrel down. As Tapun was getting some good leverage early here on the gank plank, but oh goodness, Renekton's doing Renekton things. Conqueror gonna proc, and Tapun a little unhealthy after that trade. Oh, here comes Peanut.
Can he hit the smoke? If they stop his recall, he's so dead.
Yeah,
ooh,
flash,
nice
smoke
flash.
Screen. Now Tapoon's going to have to call for help, but I don't think help's coming. First blood just sitting right here under the tower. Tapoon going to do what he can to try and survive. Going to get stunned. Going to get orange up, and now he's going to flash out of the wave, and it's first blood. Peanut LGD on the scoreboard.
A good attempt there, but we saw what Longjin was trying to do, trying to whittle down the gangplank because he knew that Graves was playing to the top side. This is what LPL teams are pretty darn good at, which is playing your lanes to where the jungler is pathing, and that's exactly what happens. You can be that aggressive because you know you have backup. Worst things happen, your jungler is there, so you take a 2v2 and you have a health advantage, so you can be playing that far up. The clutch move there was Peanut stopping the recall, knowing that there was no way out for GP.
Yep, now Tapoon actually going to move in and try and find Peanut. We'll see him on the Krug camp there, or at least see the camp being finished off, so does have the info. Renekton, though, did walk back to top lane. Sheen finished up for Tapoon as the CS has evened up somewhat. But early tab eyes here for the Renekton means that Long Xing should feel very comfortable here. And going to be tough, perhaps, to contest for this first break, given that they won't have TP, although Tapoon will have ulti most likely if they do go for it. And back down to the bottom side, it's good news here for Raze and Isles. They're up about 10 CS already.
Uh-oh. Okay, Pacer, we start to see what can happen here to the gangplank, because this wave is going to be fat. It's going to be building. Longjin has to stop this wave from being cleared so that the Twisted Fate can hit level 6 at the same time Renekton is 6, and then you just tower dive the gangplank who has no summoners. Let's see what Peanut does in response to this, because it is a really big possibility to obliterate this gangplank. Renekton's already level 6, but they're just looking for the bottom side, and we'll let Tapoon live another day.
Yeah, good bot priority there for Legacy. Does give them a pretty early first Drake as the Infernal Dragon goes down. Papoon, I think, yeah, he's broken that freeze. Hongxing just trying to let the wave push as late as it can. He walked up a W to barrel, by the way. Like, that's how forward Renekton is willing to play in this lane as Papoon is trying to play catch up on CS.
The Gangplank's always going to have a lot more gold just from his passive. So if he's a little bit behind, you can actually see him being relatively even in gold just from that ability. So he can't afford to fall behind. He has to prioritize the health knowing he's up against the global. And right now, the junglers don't know where they're at. They haven't seen the graves just yet, and the red buffs is spawning. So they can assume that Peanut might be in the top side at the moment. So Legacy has no problem looking for a gank here because Peanut doesn't have flash.
There's a stun there, and that's moving down to the bottom side. Kramer, no flash, no hope. But Vip's in there. He's going to get the first kill. As Mark going to try and stun it off. That damage is massive, but just barely not enough to finish off the second.
And look at where they go for the gank. They know that the wave is pushing, so that LGD is going to overextend a little bit to try to prioritize pushing that. Now, LGD will go for the blue buff, knowing that the Nidalee is not there, but there might be a bit too late to pull the trigger on the dive to the top side. The Galleon now has the ability to roam quite easily. Doesn't have TP, but his ultimate will be in range of assisting Tapoon, who already has the ultimate to diminish any threat of a dive on his lane.
Yeah, blue buff to Peanut. Hits level 6 already, but let's watch this again. I think Tally actually faked taking the blue, by the way. He went over to the left side, and Isles just lined this up perfectly.
Great use of the Fog of War there, too. They didn't know that the Herrick stun was coming from that direction there, and they just wanted to hit those three minions and maybe walk out, so right at the time that it was going to be possible for a gank, because the flash is about to come up for the Misfortune as well, so that opportunity was not there, and you already see that Babip has learned from the first gank into the mid lane, position yourself to land this spear before the crowd control hits.
Both supports are in mid lane. I think they want to play for the Herald, perhaps. As Babip also on the top side of the map. He's going to lane gank through. Oh, it's not really a gank, actually. Tapoon's not here. Babip's spear goes a little wide, but he's just going to defend the tower from the Renekton. He's looking pretty spooky here in the top lane.
He's spooky because the Twisted Fate is also positioning to the top side, as well as the Leona, so they're quite worried that they could just gank the Nidalee there, trying to catch up in CS. It'll always help out these farming junglers to catch up on what the laners are missing out, allowing you to get ahead, but just the Leona Roman Misfortune as well is going to give over a nice and easy Herald. MF, got to remember, one of her best traits is her strut. Her ability to rotate across the map is really unparalleled, and so she's going to be able to rotate over to the top side and stick to this lane with the Herald, or just base and go back to the bottom side whenever she wants. Nobody runs faster than her.
Yep, Legacy deciding to opt out this potential Herald fight. Race is pushing the bottom lane, but Tophoon is in trouble once again. This could be five people in his lane ASAP. Mark with the flash, E does land it, but the oranges are going to be burnt now. Peanut going to put him in the smoke screen, and Tophoon just getting chased down all day. Peanut looking for another kill. There's the collateral damage. Going to take down the Gangplank.
He's got his completed warrior enchantment at the moment, so he's really strong. Going to do so much damage, and they're still going to get that first brick because they popped the Herald over here. So it's just going to be gold over to raise here. But the race for first brick has already been won by LGD. This was the concern for Legacy. How is the laning phase going to play out? Clearly, LGD is going to be able to outclass them, but this is a pace that I don't think LGC was ready for phase 3. Already down over 2,000 gold, losing that first turret, and every lane, with the exception of bottom, has just been getting relentlessly shoved in.
Oh, Herald not going to get cancelled either, so it does good damage to the tier 2 tower as well. I mean, yeah, one of the lanes is going not so great right now. Tapoon down almost 30 CS to Longxing, but it's not the lane I think we expected. Tally's actually done a pretty good job just kind of floating this lane and keeping track of Xie, not letting him get out of this lane. And bottom lane's done really well on the Legacy side, but Tapoon, even though Gangplank does print a little bit of extra money, gonna have to do a lot to hold on to this Renekton that's getting so strong so quickly. Got that Village Water Cutlass already racing towards the Blade of the Ruined King, and I think the other issue is just Peanut, right? He's just brazenly walking into the enemy jungle. He knows he has priority from his solo lanes, playing exactly the way that he's known for. Just relentless aggression, because he knows he can afford to take every fight with his team behind him.
And he knows that his mid laner's ultimate is going to be a lot easier to play around than the Galio ultimate. Already in the tournament, we've seen what Galio can do when he's paired with champions like Camille or potentially the Jarvan. Here, there's really not a lot to work with on the side of Galio. You have Nidalee that has to go in, but it's not like she's stronger than Graves and has an opportunity to go in whenever she wants. So there's a hard time for finding Tally an opportunity opportunity for him to influence the map, and instead he's just losing plates and losing gold and just being bleeding pressure nonstop. With GA, he's able to collapse on everything, and that's what makes it so hard for Legacy to try to make a play, knowing that they're already behind when it comes to the mid lane rotation, and that the mid laner of Twisted Fate is going to have a much better position around the fight than the Galio can.
Yeah, quick Drake take as well. OGD, just too much pressure in these lanes for Legacy to try and answer it. And they're already up 2,000 gold, RLGD, as it is going to be a Cloud Rift and a Cloud Soul for this particular game. But Boop, to his credit, farming really well, but here's a 1v4 dive. Tally going to get out, but there's the first stun, there's the second. Flash out of there as Peanut was firing shots into the Galio, but they'll take the mid tower instead. Good ulti there, actually going to clear the way for Typhoon as Tally finishes off the rest of it, but he's busy like making sure Renekton doesn't kill him. So it's just a brief repeat from this wave.
And that's another Gangplank ultimate just used to deter a tower dive. The first one was used when the Gangplank was chased down by Leona and Graves, and now the second one to defend the mid lane. These teamfight tools that Legacy wants to use continue to be used to just survive laning. Their one hope here, Pastry, is going to be Raze, who's been farming quietly, yet a Kalista tends to have a really hard time in the mid game if she doesn't roll into it with a really big advantage. The rest of the team has to really round around her, and they do have the Taric ultimate if a team fight breaks out where LGD really overcommits to fight, but so many times we've seen the difficulties of using that kind of ultimate is so hard, and boy, this lane is so rough for Typhoon here. I think that moving forward into the next series, into the next game, you want to see more tanks into the top lane. Picks like Shen, picks like Malphite, just something that makes it so much harder for you to tower dive these lanes.
Oh, blue buff onto the Bip, I believe. Yep, did smite it away, but Peanut is just at it again. He's got two pushing solo lanes. No fear as he walks into the enemy jungle. Shiei's almost finished off this mid lane outer tower, and plates are still up for 50 seconds. Long Xing's been working on the top outer thanks to the help of Rift Herald, so that one's looking pretty low as well. It's just an all-out assault here in the early game from LGD. Legacy trying to play catch-up despite Raze looking good. 30 CS ahead of Kramer with a finished Blade of the Ruined King already. Not going to do much without a team fight. Oh, this is what we're worried about. Krums, Typhoon already used it. Going to get stunned up by GA. And that kill's not there just yet. But Bip, he's trying to fight Peanut as Tally's roamed in.
Okay. That's the Ninja Tabbies from the Gangplank, allowing him to survive that. If he didn't have that, he definitely could get one shot there. But again, that's another defensive ultimate, another global use from Legacy. They are completely reactive to what LGD is bringing to the table here. They're not finding their own play. So despite LGD being so aggressive, they are at least keeping Legacy's tools completely used in a defensive manner, which makes it so much harder for them to get these flanks and these teamfight wins. They're going to kill this Twisted Fate at the very least. He does have flash.
Yeah, he's going to try. No one in the area to help him. There's the gold card out of Shiei, but Bip though can leap back in. There's the TP in. That'll force the flash. And LGD have to burn two summoners, but they do protect their mid laner.
Oh boy, okay. Actually, I think he might not have needed to flash there. The Nidalee is not that strong just yet. Does have Murktress to survive that CC and potentially escape from what would have been the Renekton following through. But we need to see Taric and Kalista involved. I don't think we've seen a single Fates call just yet, and those are the members that can bring this back for Legacy. They have to continue to survive what LGD is doing, which has been good thus far. They haven't died that much just yet, but you got to make a proactive play on your own. It's good that they have that first dragon to stall out the soul that LGD is going to be fighting for, yet they need to make sure that they have vision to get the plays that they want. If you look at the map right now, there's a single control ward on the blue buff. They have no idea what's going on in the river, which makes it so difficult for them to move forward. They have to be grouped together, and now they've lost the crab as well, so even thinking about this dragon setup is so much rougher for them as the Twisted Fate ultimate will come through, and they're so late for this era.
Yeah, if they even wanted to fight it, right? LGD going to be first to that objective. They should be able to take it down. Raze is going to be busy finishing off this tower, which I like because Legacy do need the gold. The second Rift Herald is going to be even better than the first one, despite not giving any plates away. There is plenty of places where they can try and break this with. And LGD, oh, they take the mid outer as well.
They're going to be able to use this Herald wherever they want, really. You have so much time to decide where you want to pop this. Now, the bottom lane has really lost a lot of value at the moment, and going down there past the 20-minute mark really gets to be a liability at Source. If the enemy team can always react and start Baron for you. So I think that the best use for it moving forward is just going to be when you get a team fight win, you can just pop it in the lane that is closest to you and try to get as much value out of that. Let's see if anything happens. Top lane, there's a big wave here. It looks like Renekton's just going to farm it up and make sure that he can crash this, as the priority from LGD right now is around the bottom side and around the dragon. If Legacy can secure mid lane priority, they're going to have an easier time rotating this Galio and having his ultimate be a presence.
Renekton doesn't have TP, so Legacy will at least get a 4v4, but Peanut's popping Herald mid, so they're going to have to deal with this first.
They're faster to the rotation. Look at where Legacy was. They were so focused on the bottom lane. They're now slow to this. They're going to lose a tier 2, and then LGD can just rotate over to the dragon, and Legacy will have so much terrain to traverse through before even reaching and seeing the objective.
Get the Herald down, but as you said, LGD have all this time now to rotate everybody over to the dragon. That's going to have to be given up, I believe. Legacy can't get in the area to contest for the objective, so they will give the second Drake over to LGD. As that gold lead's continuing to grow, 4,000 gold up now for LGD. Actually, 3,000. Math is hard.
Math is hard, and you know what's also really hard? Pastry drafting, because so many times what you think is going to play out ends up being differently. I think that Legacy thought that the laning phase was going to be a lot easier to get through. That's why you have the Gangplank, you have the Galio, but these are all lanes that are going to lose naturally to what LGD drafted, and the short range of Kalista doesn't actually allow you to combo that well. I think I really would have liked to have seen that Jhin, something to pair to the range and add to an engage factor for Legacy. The Kalista, yes, has engaged, but you do have to play so well in the early laning phase. I'd like to see them move away from laning emphasis in the next game and really focus on what got them here, which was team fighting, making sure that you actually have every bit of tools of crowd control to pick on the enemy. Legacy can punish LGD because they have quite a few members that can get caught on their own that do like to go on these individual side quests, and if you catch somebody there, you get, you chain a few of those picks with the right champions, and then you just get those objectives for free because you get 4v5s left, right, and center.
Yeah, I think team fighting still good for Legacy in this comp, although maybe a bit different from other comps they've shown us. But getting a team fight seems to be the hard thing right now. With mid outer steel being up, it's really hard to get into the river and then get vision down. We've seen LGD just have, I mean, basically full control of, you know, their half and part of Legacy's half of the map for the last 5 to 10 minutes.
Well, the Taric won't even get you the right team fight, right? He doesn't even have the range to engage onto you. He's melee. They're looking for Peanut here. Stun does not connect.
Good buff for the ulti there for Peanut to get out from under the Taric stun. And bottom out is going to fall as a result. Chia and Kramer just smacking the tower. Vitaly not having nearly enough AP to clear that out. So Legacy just going to have to wait between dragons, I think. Thavip is farming up a storm. Like, he's still 20 CS ahead of Peanut, but Peanut's got 2 kills. He's working on a Black Cleaver. Vip's working on his Zhonya's.
So rare for a farmed Nidalee that doesn't actually have an entire team with a solid scoreline behind her to be relevant here. She's just going to be relegated to surviving in these fights with the Zhonya's and maybe getting a Grail, but you're not even boosting a hyper carry here. The Kalista hasn't done a whole lot just yet, doesn't have the Ginsu's if that's what she's going. Probably will just be going for the Hurricane second to try to deal with all the diving members of LGD. Yet Nidalee, if you're not getting ahead early, you really just end up being a secondary support and you don't have a hyper carry, so LGD is going to have to really just find an incredible Fates Call for these fights. As you can actually pair Fates Call with the Taric ultimate and the Galio to do quite a bit of damage, and it'd be ideal if you could actually land that on top of an ulting Misfortune, because nobody else is really going to have the right angle to stop her. Yes, Tally has found plenty of teleport flanks to go for it, but he doesn't have the teleport up just yet. He just swapped to it, though, so maybe he does have the vision to see that Kramer has to be stopped from his ultimate channeled.
I guess we'll find out, because we haven't had a full 5v5 yet. LGD just happy to play the side lane with their big Renekton and their big Twisted Fate. Can't say I blame them. Xie is going to go ahead and split push the bottom lane. And Longxing has just been permanently pushing. I mean, the top lane is so long. There's no tier 2 tower there. It's just the inhib tower. So, yeah, Renekton's going to get spotted, but he's just going to pressure things in. He's got the TP for the minute 25 mark when the dragon roams in. LGD have completely taken over Legacy's jungle. And Tapoon's in a potential 1v4. At least the 1v3 here as Mark's just off to the side, and Babib's gonna have to come down to try and help out.
Oh, it's brutal. They don't have a way to engage. They just don't have it. The Nidalee doesn't find it. You don't even have the vision because LGD is doing such a fine job in denying it. You only have that one ward in the back of the Red Brush, but because of the terrain, you still don't even have the right angle there. So only Tally could potentially use that here, yet they're still just bleeding turrets left and right, and LGD can always disengage quite effectively there. You can use Leona ultimates and gold cards to get away from what LGC Legacy is throwing at you. These are going to be a confusing series, Pastry. LGC, LGD, but anyways, Legacy needs to have a better setup for these team fights. You need to engage. You can't just bleed out the entire game.
Yeah, and it's tough again with how much control LGD have exerted across the map, how good their setup and their vision is being was lacking in the early stages of this tournament in their play. And Legacy, they're finally going to posture aggressively. Good dash out from Peanut, but Legacy want to fight for this dragon because you call it Crumbs, Race is gone Ginsu's. Legacy are really committing to this 5v5, the first one of this game. They do have the inside track already onto the objective, but they're gonna have to make it quick. Solar Flare hits Raze, cleanses out. There's Tally going in, finds the taunt there. Stun lands in as well, but Legacy need to commit a little bit more. Tally gonna flash out. Collateral damage over the top. Longxing getting poked a little bit by the Gangplank as the ulti gets committed, and Legacy will start the dragon.
They still have Taric ultimate. This could be the fight for Legacy. If Tally can TP and find a really good flank, this could be it, though. Misfortune still has ultimate.
Careful of Renekton, though. They're going to spot him now, finally, but I think it's too late. Raze going to get stunned from so far away as Longxing going to take down the Kalista. A second kill already as the bot lane for Legacy has fallen, and Babip's going to have to run out of there. The dragon will be forfeit. Two kills given over as well, as LGD only getting stronger and stronger.
This sneaky crocodile finds Kalista, and her clans had been burned earlier from the Leona, so it was so easy to delete her. They can now turn to the Baron. They get everything. Pastry, I think this game is all but done here. Legacy just got outclassed early from LGD, and they have been clean. They just don't get the fights. They just focus on objectives and don't give the opportunity for Legacy to get the fight that they want.
Yeah, it's looking so much more clinical now, RLGD. Certainly scary as this team looks towards the main event of Worlds 2020, but still a long way from that one here, but certainly this game looking very good for LGD as they finish off the Baron.
I think Legacy can shake this one off though, but first we're gonna look at this flank though. Great control ward there from Langjin, and then Kalista steps up, so easy to immediately delete her. No heal to save her a little bit longer to buy time for the Taric ultimate, but it wouldn't have even mattered. She would have gone down at the end. Doesn't have enough damage to burn through the LGD diving pair of Leona and Renekton.
Just a nice easy setup there. It's always nice. Renekton can just walk his way into the back line. Legacy not able to find that 5v5 they've just been looking for. Every fight has been unfair. And LGD are going to look to keep it that way with the Baron buff pushing down. Only inhibitor towers to take alongside the Nexus ones. There are no tier 2s left. They were already very effectively 4-1ing slash 1-3-1ing with this Twist of Fate and Renekton, and now it's going to get even better with this Baron.
So LGD just want to buy their time and allow the Renekton to crash the wave into the bottom. They want to pressure three lanes at the same time. You want to have all three drawing the attention out of Legacy so that you can maximize what you're doing with that empowered minion wave. So now that the Renekton is crashing, you can see what LGD is trying to do with mid and top, and that's going to draw away the members of Legacy, divide and conquer a composition that's already having such a hard time team fighting, an even worse time laning. This is just going to put an even bigger deficit on them.
Alright, well, Longxing gonna go ahead, push down this. Waves are crashing it around the same time, very well coordinated there. As Tally looks for the taunt, but not gonna be found onto the Renekton. Kramer also getting aggressive, trying to hit down the tower, but not really an angle for Legacy to look for here. I mean, every single inhibitor tower is currently being pressured.
That was a good rotation there out of Peanut. I'm really impressed that they've actually been able to crash these waves so consistently. They're getting some value out of the Lich Bane and RFC as well. And there it is, divide and conquer. You see that Taric and Kalista were in the bottom side. Well, surprise, the Misfortune was able to rotate to the top side. You've just broken one of these turrets down. And when you start to open up the base and you're dealing with a Twisted Fate, you can never leave. The threat of a backdoor becomes all too real here. So this is a big milestone for LGD in closing out this game. The noose is tightening.
Certainly is, and still 30 seconds left on this Baron, so another wave at least is going to crash in. She is going to go ahead and finish off this inhibitor. The cannon is going to do it. And mid lane, oh, Race was actually the target. That cleanse, not good enough as the bullet time comes in. She is almost flanking all the way around the back of the mid inhibitor tower. But Legacy just kind of getting crawled into their own base now. Bavip going to get blasted by Peanut's ulti. They're going to go on for GA now, but the exhaust is good. Still the damage is there. Going to rip the spears out, but it's not enough to take him down. Fates call in. Ultimate pop for Taric, but sheer interstasis he goes. Surely they can get one kill. Indeed they will, as Raze will finally pick up the pesky Xie. And on they go again. Raze looking for Long Xing. Going to try and keep the kills going. Renekton getting low, but he's pretty tanky. Mark here as well. Tally with a three-man taunt. And they're still going. Mark surely is going to die. Indeed, Raze will get a second kill. But a slim consolation prize at the end of that push. LGD did so much damage with that Baron.
Yeah, they finally get the fight that they wanted, but at a huge cost there, because now the entire base turrets are gone. Only your Nexus turrets are alive. You've lost double inhibitors, and the Baron, yes, it went down, but it was so much value from LGD. You still have the teleport available from the Twisted Fate, and once he's up, once he can start to port in, you can even pair it with the Renekton's TP to backdoor here. So we're going to look at GA overstepping there, getting a little bit too greedy. Could have potentially retreated to the top side, but you can almost never fault somebody for wanting to group up with the rest of his team, knowing that you have safety in numbers.
And look at how they had to start this fight. Raze did all of the initiation work.
We've seen players like Tactical in the LCS having pop-up performances on the Kalista there, but knowing that your best engage as a Kalista happens at the 25-minute mark doesn't really strike you as the optimal way of playing Kalista here. They're going to lose up this Cloud Soul, which is going to be really deadly for somebody like the Leona or even the Renekton that can just pop ultimate and immediately find the engage. They're looking for more fights, and they're going to catch Graves.
Peanut stun raise. This is an easy kill. See you later, Peanut! Spears, oh, he's not in range. That's a heartbreaker. Isle's now going to get stunned up, and Mark, he's found just that. Race is going to get stunned up, but Tally going to look to save the day. Mark now made a pink cushion as Xie will finally take down Tally, but Legacy, they're going to keep fighting him. Race, he needs to stay alive, but it's not going to be all that easy. Already killed by the Renekton. It's going to be absolutely falling to pieces here for the Oceanic lads as LGD look to put the finishing touches on this game. That's quite the TP. Very,
they really want him.
Aggressive from Shea, we'll call it. Perhaps disrespectful. RFC gonna proc in. See you later, Babip. And that's gonna be the ace for LGD. That's gonna be game one for LGD as they'll finish off the first Nexus on their way to the world's main event.
Quite collected of a game. You only had 12 kills in 29 minutes there, but it never felt like LGD was in danger of losing that. We knew what their game plan was going to be from the start. These lane advantages easily translated into these teamfight wins, and I think that the recollection from what you get from these games for both teams is pretty straightforward. LGD will try to get the same draft and give us a repeat of that one, whereas Legacy will have to break this apart. I love the Orianna and the Syndra focus there, but you can't overlook the Twisted Fate. It's a really important pick for a lot of teams here at Worlds, and it often tends to be a bit of a clutch. You do need a lot of games to be able to play around Twisted Fate, and if you can ban that out to these players that are fairly reliant on him, well, you might have actually just weakened their entire composition because you're not as practiced on the other champions.
I think the other thing, just kind of thinking about that game, is like, it just felt so hard to contain LGD in the mid game, which is actually where I thought maybe Legacy could get some footing. Like, LGD have always been good individually, right? Even at the start of playing, when they were making all these mistakes, it often wasn't in the laning phase where they were looking bad. Actually, they looked quite good still, but they just fell apart around objectives and Peanut couldn't hit a smite to save himself. That is not the story of this current LGD, as Peanut is playing all the way back to form when he was, you know, in an MSI final a few years ago. So it's looking certainly spooky. Legacy, I think they have the tools to do it, but not after that game one, a very decisive look for LGD. And while we wait for game number two, you can listen to KDA's Popstars on the League of Legends official playlist on Spotify.
Welcome back to the State Farm Analyst Desk. LGD, they've kicked things off with a dominant win. We're going to take a closer look at exactly how they did it. The brains of this brigade is Vedius and, of course, Cadril on the end there. Bit of British representation. We may not be very good at video games, but we're good at talking about them. Of course, Cadril, a bit of an exception to the rule.
I love how
just flames me out of nowhere.
You just look at both of us like, no good gamers here.
I mean, I'm just saying there's more Union Jacks on the desks than there is in the esports realms. That's all I'm saying. That, you can't argue that one.
I agree.
But guys, let's start putting our thinking caps on for this one. The draft, I think, is actually, as always, a good place to start. And when we focus on that, did you get what you expected?
I mean, you know, Machine, I was kind of hoping that you would, you know, stroke our egos a little bit.
You want some more?
All of the contested picks that we talked about
can I remember
at the beginning
them all?
Of the day
Nidalee.
All showed up in this draft.
Nidalee?
Yep.
You mentioned Graves.
Yep.
TF.
Yep.
Leona.
Yep.
I'm missing one. Galio. I did it.
Five for five.
I listen. Sometimes.
No, exactly that. And this is exactly what Cadril and I like. Cadril pretty much predicted the whole draft from start to finish when we were sitting in the green
room.
So it was one of those situations where we knew what both these teams wanted to do coming into this draft. Mm-hmm. And there were a couple question marks. Both Mark and I questioned like some of the ban priorities.
Lots of Mark.
Yeah, like why is it they actually allowed the Leona to get through?
For
but
Mark.
What I thought was for Mark. We're making too many jokes, too many Brits.
Guys,
too many
I'm just saying we're
bus.
Having way too much fun here, okay? Yes. This is video
Rain
games. It has to be serious.
Rein it in. Rein it in, gentlemen.
Serious video games. Cadril. Nice. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Please,
no,
carry
please.
On.
The main point that I wanted to get at was, coming into this draft, my concern was individual differences, right? So, when you have a draft like this for LGD, number one, Xie has a winning matchup into the Galio, Renekton has a winning matchup into the Gangplank, and Kalista, Taric, while typically very strong 2v2 lane, can struggle early levels against a Misfortune Leona. So you're giving an LGD roster who, in theory on paper, should be stronger individually, winning lanes across the board that should be able to dominate. What was interesting was how I felt BABIP actually did a lot in the early game to actually mitigate some of the struggles that a Legacy could have faced.
I agree. I think BABIP kind of did what he could with what he had, if that makes sense. I think if you pick they first picked Nidalee and they wanted Renekton, it was obvious. So they picked their way on side of LGD. They went for Graves as well with the TF. So they had actually a really good top side. The problem is GP Nidalee is terrible. It's garbage. There's no setup whatsoever. You can't play top side. You have no winning 2v2s. So you could see that Tophoon was just kind of stuck under his tower, getting dove by Peanut level 4. BABIP was always bot side because his only reliable CC was the Taric. And the mid 2v2 is also not great if you're playing the same magic damage into the TF. So I didn't like the top pick. I would have liked to see something like even a losing matchup like Camille just gives you more agency. But yeah, just in general, I wasn't a fan.
I mean, so like it's clear LGD have a game plan, you know, like they're doing the same thing we've been talking about this whole time. The fact you predicted the draft is a perfect, you know, explanation of that. So my question is, if you're Legacy, you know, pound for pound, you may not be able to hang and that your victory will probably be seeded in that draft. What do you take away from them? Surely, you know, that TF is a prospect that you can't be giving them for five games straight.
I think you should target more towards jungle or something.
Okay.
Try and single something out. I think at the moment they're singling out mid, but they're giving CA TF anyway, so you can ban like away the Orianna, the Syndra, stuff like this. But if you still give him TF, it doesn't make much sense. May as well just stick to something like TF Orianna, try to put him on something different. You could also target Mark a bit, and I feel like when it came to 4-5's bans, you ban away Rakan, but that's it. Then you gave them Leona, which didn't make sense. By banning away the Ezreal, you gave them Leona, Mark's best champion. He's got like 20 games on it, 70% win rate, and his second champ is Nautilus with like 30% win rate. So it's like, can you take away some of these key picks? Giving him Renekton is fine, giving Graves is fine, giving him F is fine, but I think the TF Leona for me is like, either deny it or find something that counters it, because it's not Galio and it's not Taric.
I think that what we're seeing here is that like there's a lot of draft question marks, and ultimately when it came to the fights, this is where Legacy would struggle because they needed the perfect setup in order to be able to win them out, and this was really the deciding fight that resulted in LGD being able to get the win. And you'll notice that at the start of it, Legacy actually invested all of their ultimates to actually commit to the fight, so that when the re-engage and the recommit to the Drake happened, it was very easy for LGD to actually get that collapse. And I think that what this showcases is much more of the patience that we got to see from LGD in their series versus Rainbow Seven. When playing around these objectives, when it came to their reapproach, number one, they had a very strong team fight setup, but two, they waited for those ultimates to come up. They waited for that right opportunity. They set a up the flank, and they did everything that they were supposed to do in order to reclaim that objective. So I think LGD, again, continuing to show growth throughout these.
The problem with Legacy's comp is they have the Kalista Taric, right, which is your main engages with the GP ult. So once you use those spells, there's no going back. If you Kalista ult, or if you Taric ult, or if you GP ult, you have to go in.
Right.
Whereas with LGD, they could just throw the Leona ult, get the cleanse back off, Destiny, try to find a Sun back off, Renekton can flash in. So they have like these poke and prod engages, whereas Legacy, once the trigger's pulled, you can't unpull it, right? So that was the kind of problem that I saw with the team comp in general. There wasn't too much synergy between the champions either. There wasn't like hard winning lanes. I think that you need to kind of draft around. If you're going to pick GP, try to play a scaling mage rather than a Galio, because Galio doesn't have much impact. He needs to jump on someone, and there was no real person to jump on. So that's why I think something like the Camille, although you're losing the lane, it just makes it better.
Yeah, and LGD, their strategy, you could describe it as a death by a thousand cuts. I like the way you describe that. You know, they can just force out cooldowns until they have that advantage. Then they can lock it down, and locking it down, we shall, because let's take another look at LGD's Mercedes drive to victory. It was a great engage from none other than Mark, and I'm not talking Lamont. We can check it out now.
Yeah, this is where Legacy were trying to turn, try and find a fight in the jungle, but Mark with the engage just gets on the back line. He's essentially 1v4 back there while Tally tries to buy time on the other side, and Mark actually lives. He gets away, stone plate, and he bought so much time, enough for his team to collapse and just kill everyone.
He's a pretty good Leona player, and while his impact wasn't the strongest throughout the series, I think that this was definitely showcasing what he's capable of on the champion. And obviously, LGD looking good in game one. I think that's the big takeaway. But for me, my positives from Legacy was that I thought that LGD would just stomp all the lanes and that the Nidalee wouldn't be able to do anything. Mm. But Barbip ganked mid early to alleviate some of the pressure, and he actually did a good job of keeping that CS differential in mid pretty even. He found a successful kill bot in the 2v2, and I felt like that, okay, he's actually finding some things in these lanes. The problem is that it's so much easier for LGD to do exactly the same and get so much more for it. So I think that if we see a couple of draft adaptations and a few differences, there is a world where Babip can have that early game influence to actually help Legacy get a W on the board.
Yeah, I mean, with Babip as well, you have to remember that this is the first loss he's had on Nidalee so far this tournament. 100% win rate coming into this best of five. So to come into a best of five against, you know, a Goliath as the David, and to have your comfort pick that you haven't lost on at Worlds immediately taken from you, already you can see how that's going to start spurring them down a downward spiral, potentially. But we'll only find out through the gameplay itself. It's been a pleasure. Thank you, Cadril. Thank you, Vedius. We'll be right back, because time for us to step away. But on the other side of this break, Legacy and LGD continues.
Hey Mercedes, legends run wild, each one unique, with astonishing power, unstoppable, master warriors, ready to compete.
Shodai.
Seeking glory. We live it, we breathe it, we have each other's back. Together, we become legends, icons of a new generation.
Born free as the wind blows, as free as the grass grows, born free to follow your heart. Live free and beauty surrounds you.
Axe, smell ready.
Greatness accepts no lag, no delay, no excuses. It lives in the tiny space between milliseconds and nanoseconds, between memes and legends, between tears and tears. And when margins that small make an impact this big, nothing less than the speed and dependability of the Cisco network will do.